And to moderate this fantastic session, we have the pleasure to have the wonderful Francine Lacroix from Bloomberg TV, who's going to, I'm sure, make a terrific job.
Thank you so much, Xavier. Thank you. Gentlemen, thank you and welcome. We're talking about innovation. Innovation is a word that's used a lot. Mike, let's start with you. What does innovation mean to you, and how do you harness it?
Well, the essence of innovation is you don't know what you're going to build. You don't know how you're going to make it, what color it's going to be, who's going to finance it, who's going to buy it, or what you're going to use it for. You can't answer any of those questions if you're an innovator. And the reason that government never innovates is before the public spends money, they want answers to all those questions. But since they can't get them, they're not willing to make investments in things that are different and strange and disruptive. Innovation disrupts. And innovation, when it's successful, brings us enormous benefits. But real innovation is something that you and I wouldn't have thought possible, wouldn't have even occurred to us. That's what innovators do.
Emmanuel, do you agree?
I do agree. I think innovation is about disruptive and absolute change. At the very beginning, you don't know what you will create, what you will invent. It's about deep tech, exactly what we saw all around this place. And a lot of people here are involved in this deep tech. I mean, but it could be innovation in society, in a lot of different sectors. It's about disruption, profound change, and unexpected consequences. And very often, innovation is about precisely crossing different competences and different sectors and managing to invent new steps forward, because basically, you will push people coming from big data, for instance, to work with nanotech and, neurology and something like that. I mean, the ability to go across different sectors, across different competences, is today one of the critical aspects of innovation.
But Mike, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, I think the classic example of innovation was Impressionism. Can you imagine what the old masters painters thought when they first saw something today from Picasso or something like that? They would have said, this is not art, doesn't take skill, this is just my kids could do it, and yet none of those things are true. It really is a whole nother art form, but it all of a sudden came on and it disrupted everything that we ever thought about art.
But can you teach innovation, or is it something that you're actually, that's inbuilt?
No, I think you can teach innovation a little bit, but in the end, you have to have a new idea, and you have to have confidence, because the fact that it's new means there's no supporters for it, and you have to build a support group, and if you're starting a business, you go through, your family's just so thrilled that you're starting something new when they brag about it. But as you get into it in the development process and before you become wildly successful like a Mark Zuckerberg or somebody, your family starts to say, well, I know you're right and you should keep doing it, but maybe you want to take a job on the side just in case. And that's when you have to stand up and say, are they right or not? And I think what kept me going when I started my company was a little bit of the fear of, not failure, but the embarrassment of telling somebody that it wasn't going to work. So just my ego kept me going, and then finally one day it worked, and then people say, oh, I was with you all along. I don't remember it that way, but...
I think it's very difficult to, teach innovation, but you can teach specific skills or sectors, and very innovative people are very smart or very good in one domain, one sector. But the critical competence is probably to be a risk taker. I mean, on top of these competences and what you can teach at school, you have people able to take risk, to fail, to doubt, and to move forward because they don't know at the very beginning what they will discover. And to convince people to take risk with them because, one of the critical point, and a lot of people in this room should experience that, is that if you take the risk alone, it doesn't work. So you have to convince people to take risk with you.
Can the government help?
The government definitely can help. First, by providing this these skills by helping people to be teach and to research and to create the key conditions for innovation. First point. I mean, this sort of common floor. And providing public financing to labs for fundamental research and so on is very important. Second, it's to create basically the good economic environment to attract talents. Because to innovate, you need talents. That's the most important thing. That's your raw material. And attracting talents is one of the mission of obviously all these corporates, but government could help by the good macroeconomic environment with taxes, social rights and so on. And third, you can help to provide the good financial environment because the critical stuff to innovate, and especially with disruptive innovation, is to help people to raise money and especially equity.
How did you start Bloomberg?
Well, I got fired from my job and I was too proud to go look for another one. So I said, well, I better work for myself. Seriously, part of that is true. I was fired from my job. It's the best thing that ever happened to me. If you get fired that way, you should say thank God. But I had an idea and I was lucky enough to have the wherewithal to finance it myself. And so I was able to attract three people who had been working for me at the company I got fired from. And they joined me. The first day it was me, second day we were four people. And we just had an idea and we developed it. And it took us three years, I think, from the start of the business till we delivered our first product. It took us the first year, you know it's gonna work. You just have all that enthusiasm. And the last year, you can see that it's gonna work, so you don't have to worry about it. It's that middle year that's always the tricky one. But I went out and I spent 3 years to sell the product. And you just have to have the confidence that if you keep going and knocking on doors, you will eventually find a buyer. I've always thought whether it's in government or in business, you have to lead. So what I would argue in business is we all talk about listening to our customers. And I think that's okay, but I would say what you should do is hear your customers out. But if you build what your customer wants, by the time you get it there, they've moved on to something else. And so what you have to do is build what they're going to need down the road and then convince them when you have the product that it is in their interest to buy it and use it. And in government, that would be leading from the front. Nobody elects a government official to ask them in a poll what they want and then deliver it. They should be electing government officials to come up with ideas for the future and then convince them why it's okay and why they should fund it and live under that kind of an environment and go on. So you have to have an idea. You have to figure out who to sell it to. You have to go out and sell. And selling is a very key part of every bit of innovation, whether you're selling yourself to somebody to fund it, or you're selling the product to somebody, or you're just selling your family to bear with you while you go through this adventure. Successful entrepreneurs, in my way of thinking, are always good salesmen. Some may not be polished, but they're very effective in terms of convincing people that they've got an idea and it's worth listening to or investing in or buying.
What's the most difficult thing? An entrepreneur, you spoke to many of them. Is it the doubt? Is it the funding? What kind of support have they asked you for?
I mean, it depends on the different institution and sectors, but when you speak to entrepreneurs, first, I mean, as a former minister, I loved entrepreneur. Because they are the only one not to ask anything to ministers and to the government, I have to say. Because when you have a lot of incumbents and a lot of large companies, they are used to deal with governments and they ask for some advantages, some specific measures for the sectors. But an entrepreneur is somebody who is able to survive in any condition. I think that's one of the critical features of being an entrepreneur. What they ask is just not to change their environment every day because they want to be focused on clients and they want to be focused on delivering this innovation. The critical thing is to provide, for me as a government, the most, I mean, adapted environment for them, which means, as I told you, to help them to create the right culture. I think this place and what is done in this place, and Hello Tomorrow is part of it, is precisely part of this new culture we need for entrepreneurship and for innovation. And the role of the government and the role of public bodies is to help to provide that, not to be a substitute, it's absolutely impossible, not to prescribe, but to help to provide this good environment with positive message by de-risking the failure, which means you will probably fail when you decide to take risk. You have to reduce the cost of failure, and you have to make a failure as rapid and with very few consequences as possible. And third, you have to celebrate successes, which is critical to create positive examples and people pushing some others to succeed.
And you think France and Europe is actually the right home for it. The US and the Americans seem to be doing it better because there's the badge of getting it wrong but picking yourself up, and they have bigger companies. Is it a funding problem or is it the mentality?
I think in the US they started much before for this last generation of innovation. We had great successes in Europe after World War II, and in this country especially with a lot of large companies. We are country number one in terms of large companies in Europe. So we definitely, we didn't start in the 80s, 90s. But if you look at the past few years, I think there is now a new dynamic in terms of entrepreneurship and innovation. Why? Because we have good innovation in this country, public and private. French people are creative, innovative. You have a lot of smart people in different academic research and so on. And what we're trying to do and what we are doing, and when I say we, it's people, probably people in this room. The new generation is definitely managing to convert this creativity, this French talents into entrepreneurship, which is a pretty new feature. So that's brand new. And when you look at the situation today, we are number one in startup creation in continental Europe. 1,000 a year, which is a new feature during the past 3 years, and it's not very well known in the rest of the world. These people, these entrepreneurs, are creating a new culture in this country. They are changing large caps, they are changing the way to innovate, they are promoting open innovation in this country, and the fact that BNPP was here and Jean right before us is a very good signal. I mean, 5 to 6 years ago, I think it was almost impossible to see a large French bank promoting such an event and being so much involved in innovation. And you have a lot of French large caps involved in this field. Now, what we need in our country and in Europe is a big acceleration. It's not just to start up, it's to scale up. And we need to have the actual financial ecosystem to promote and push this innovation. And there is a lack of equity, and there is a lack of a deep market, and especially venture capitalists in France and in Europe to accompany this
trend. One of the things about innovation in new companies is the fatality rate is high. It's always going to be high. And so if you want to encourage innovation, you have to have a society that does not penalize failure. I remember when I first came to Europe back in 1967, I think it was, sitting at a table and the people were talking about how they wouldn't do business with so-and-so. Why? Because his father, 30 years earlier, had gone bankrupt. And in America, you hear people say, oh, isn't it wonderful? My son is on his fourth company so far. And it's just a different mindset that in some cases you live with a stigma and in other cases it's an attribute almost.
I think one point we have to improve in continental Europe and in France is to push people to be much more risk takers, which was less natural in our culture than in the Anglo-Saxon culture. But in the same time, all of us have a great challenge to deal with.
Is that at school? Do you become a risk taker? You taught it when you're two?
That's a question. Yeah, you're right. It starts in the education, but a lot of French people, for instance, traveled a lot and spent a few years in the US, in the UK and so on, and in Asia. And I think this culture is changing, and they are changing de facto the French culture, and they will push for a new sort of education, promoting individuals, risk-taking, and so on. But at the same time, and I wanted to insist on that because it refers to what Mike's pointed a few minutes ago, it's about potential consequences of innovation. Because when you have risk-takers in your country, when you like innovation, it's good, it's probably easier. But at the end of the day, you have potential negative consequences of innovation. You will kill jobs. You will disrupt your economy, which means that you will kill some sectors. So you have losers in a very innovative and disruptive world. And in our countries, and especially in France, we had a sort of by-principle reaction to say, we are careful with innovation, especially public bodies, because of the potential consequences of this innovation. We are changing the state of mind to to push innovation and promote innovation. But all of us in the world have to deal with these consequences, even if you push and if you promote innovation. And one of the key questions of our democracies today in the US with your debate, a few months ago in Great Britain with the Brexit, in France, in our countries, how do you speak to the losers of innovation and globalization? And if you are not able to explain the play, that everybody will have a place in this new world, if you are not able to explain that even people who will be disrupted by this innovation, we will find a new place, a new role, a new job for them, and it's part of innovation, you will be killed. So my point is to say, first, entrepreneurs, as Mike said, have social responsibility. But second, we need much more social and political innovation to accompany this technological innovation.
Mike, this is something that when you were mayor of New York, you also focused on.
Government is different than business in the fact that the stockholders, if you will, have a vote. They pick management, and that gets management to behave very differently. Typically in a corporation, management is isolated from the stockholders by a board of directors, and that lets them be, I think, more innovative and able to try to pick the next product. Also in business, you have the discipline of going out of business of bankruptcy. Governments never stop, they go on forever. But in a company, if you don't do it right, the marketplace forces you out and opens a place for the next company to come along. And I think that's why you see governments not changing as rapidly as companies. On the other hand, governments survive for very long times. And if you look at the number of companies that have survived 20 years, you'd be shocked at how few. 50 years, almost none. 75 years, you can count them on one hand. So it is really different. And you can't expect government to change as much as you can have change companies. On the other hand, remember, most governments provide a service that people need and continues. Most new companies start businesses that don't have a product that people in the end want. And if you want to have a successful business, you've got to do three things. You've got to have a product that people need and will buy. You have to have a ways to monetize that product, and you have to have a ways to protect that product. Government doesn't have to do any of those things, at least not quickly. And so when you see a startup and they've invented a new ways to open and close your garage door from 3,000 miles away, you ooh and you ah and say, isn't that wonderful? But nobody really needs that product. And I think that's a lot of the entrepreneurs, they just haven't ever gone out and tried to sell their product and see whether the customer has a use for it. And an awful lot of these, they start up and say, well, we'll figure out how to monetize it later on. But in the end, somebody's got to pay you. I hate to think it comes back to capitalism, but the great ideas only work if you can get money to pay your employees and pay your investors back. And the other problem, of course, is if you come up with a great idea, overnight, 10 people are going to try to copy it, and you've got to find a ways to keep them from doing that, or you'll be a nice footnote in the history of modern capitalism, but you're not going to be rich.
Do you remember the most difficult part when Bloomberg was a startup? Was there a difficult week or a difficult day?
Our original strategy was to do something that nobody else was doing. So the protection at the beginning was these big companies around us wouldn't jump on us right away. And maybe by the time we got the product out there, it would be too late. And we would have first mover advantage, which if you're out there and have a product you're selling is a very big deal. And we kept changing the product all the time. So the big companies that wanted to compete with us, they would do a study, they'd carefully try to figure out what we were doing, they would write a business plan to produce that product, but by the time they got it, we'd moved on to the next generation. And eventually, they couldn't catch up and just most of them went out of business. But you have to figure out how you can keep your product different than the others, but also why people will pay for your product. A lot of things people want, but they're just not going to pay for it.
And this is something, again, the vision, right, that you need to then start and grow a company. Compared to the US, how's the funding in France? Because the funding is one of the major problems, that you don't actually put scale behind them. So I think of Uber, I think of Airbnb, I think of a lot of companies that could have been created in France, but that actually took market share quite quickly, that French companies haven't.
Yeah, the funding issue is not something for starting companies in this country. I mean, we had some issues, but now you have the first generation of entrepreneurs becoming new business angels. And a lot of people are committed to the ground, the Niel, the Grandjean, the Simoncini, and so on. And they invested a lot in startups, and you have a new generation again investing. Second, you have now big players on the ground investing in startups, innovation and disruptive innovation for the first tickets. You have BPI, BPI, Banque Publique Investissement, Nicolas Dufourcq was around. And they played a very great role for these first stages. The key question is beyond 100 million tickets, which is critical in some sectors. In biotech, when your time to market is quite long, for instance, we are a very good place for biotech. We were number one in terms of listening in Europe last year. But one of the critical points for the French environment is now to be able to finance large tickets. Otherwise, a lot of our startups financed at the very beginning by French or European investors or held by the government through tax reliefs and so on are, in a certain way, forced to go to the US, to Asia, to the UK
for funding.
So you have two answers in order to deal with this issue. The first one is to build or reinforce a venture capital environment in this country, and we are improving, but one of the critical points is to attract VCs coming from the US, from China, from Israel, where you have a deep market in these countries, to push them to invest and to be much more present in this country, and pushed a lot for that. They are starting to invest now in these startups. And second is to facilitate M&A and listening to these companies, because all the potential investors want to have visibility on the exit, especially at this level of tickets. So what they want to understand is, what's the option for me to exit in 3 to 5 or 10 years? And we had very few M&A for our startups with French and European large caps. It's changing. And it's part of the change of this culture, because we need open innovation. We need now to have much more habits in large cap size to work with the startups to precisely build their own innovation by getting and buying some startups. And when you look at the past decade, we had much more exits with American large caps than with European large caps, which was absolutely unacceptable. And second, you need to facilitate the listening of these startups or these unicorns when they reach a certain level. in order to facilitate such an exit. That's critical in terms of financing. So it's how to accelerate medically this financial place to be much more startup friendly.
There's an awful lot of good ideas out there, and there aren't very many companies that succeed. And you got to ask yourself, what's the disconnect between the two? And I think it's people don't understand when they start a business, you have to have a good idea, but the execution of building a business, of attracting the right people, of getting them to work together, of finding financing if you need it, of going and selling the product, of maintaining the product, and being able to recognize what the competitors are doing. Those are skill sets that most entrepreneurs don't have. They tend to be young people, straight out of school. It's amazing to me the ideas that they come up with, but they have never had the experience of the real world. It's not easy to look somebody in the eye and say, I'm sorry, you're not going to work here tomorrow. It's not easy to get two people, both of whom you have to keep, both of whom you really need, who aren't getting along, to adjudicate between them and to get them to cooperate. You deal with social problems, you deal with government problems, you deal with tax problems, you deal with legal problems. And I think it's the maturity of the management of these companies that is failing them because they just don't have it. They're starting young people. And that's something I suppose that a venture capitalist can bring to the party. They can give them the understanding of the real world and provide some stability. The bad news for a venture capitalist is they have a short-term perspective and they want to get their money out and they want to own a big chunk of the company. And the entrepreneurs that give away the whole company because that's the only ways they can get going, it sounds good, but why bother? You would be better off maybe starting slower, attracting a few older people to work with you who have some experience. And it's been, what I've noticed is older people don't have a problem at attracting and hiring and working with younger people. Why? Because that's the way the world is. As you get older, you have to bring in new employees. They're just out of school, so they're younger. But younger people are always afraid of bringing in older people. They just, for some reason or other, are scared of them, and they don't recognize the talents that come with experience and with having been there before and done things. And so if I was going to start a young new business, when I started my business, I was in my mid-30s, and I'd had some experience. But most of the entrepreneurs I meet here are straight out of school. They're 24, 25 years old, and they've never had to go through this, and they don't understand things they think are going to be easy that don't work out. They never quite understand why, but if somebody had been there before and done that, they could have explained to them. Not saying you can't do it, but here's the difficulties we're going to have to address rather than finding out too late.
And how do you protect the cultural DNA of the startup at Bloomberg?
Well, some of it's luck. You just you meet the right person that can help you. They give you a boost or an opportunity. Some of it's just doggedness. You have to keep going out there until you find it. Somebody once described a good salesman as somebody when you knock on a door and the potential customer slams the door in your face, you go to the next door and knock on it 100% convinced that you're going to make the sale. A great salesman knocks on the same door. And some people just have the confidence in themselves. You don't have to be polished. People want to think you believe, want to think that you're genuine. That's true whether you're running for office in government or whether you're trying to sell a product or whether you're trying to be a TV presenter like you are. People look at you. They don't expect you to know everything that the subject you're interviewing knows, but they want to know that you've thought about it and your questions are intelligent and that you really care about getting an answer. And that comes through, and that's why you're popular and somebody else is not.
Emmanuel, when you look at what you've learned, so you came from the private sector into government, what is the one thing that actually surprised you the most? That's, again, in dealing with entrepreneurs, Is there something that people misunderstand about government? You're talking about the mistrust of governments at the moment, and therefore it pushes entrepreneurs maybe even further away.
One of the key questions, especially in our country, indeed, is a lack of trust and reciprocal understanding between private and public sector. Why? Because they build their culture on each side. And you have very few people going from the private sector to the public sector, and you have very few people deciding to leave, especially the political field, to go to the private sector, which I think is part of our problem. Because for a lot of people on the ground, they have the feeling that politicians just don't understand their day-to-day life because they just live in a specific area and they just live among themselves. And basically that people's life is not the core issue for politicians. And I think that speaking about culture or DNA of a company is exactly the same as speaking about the culture or the DNA of government or politicians or private sector. I mean, you have people working together, building their own representations, creating their own reflex and the way to work all together. And one of the main points I discovered by joining the government and now trying to do something else in the political field is precisely this distance and this mistrust between the different areas. But you have a lot of things that you can improve in the political field by just importing some methods and some talents from people coming from private sectors. And I think you can change and improve private sectors by pushing some people coming from politics to go and take some responsibilities in corporates. Because I think the qualities required for people on both sides are very different, but very complementary. Because when you are involved in government affairs and politics, you are much more pushed basically to integrate a lot of complexity, to integrate side effects of what you have to decide, to integrate what we call general interest, but which means to try to see how you have to encompass all the different potential indirect effects of your decision, which will become more and more important for the private sector. And I think when you are in the private sector, you are much more focused, and what Mike described is extremely telling about that, much more focused on the delivery, direct impact, and your credibility is directly correlated to your ability to deliver and to try to find solutions to your people and especially your customers. And this kind of very efficient and direct reaction is probably one of the weakness on the political side. You have too many people with a very low focus on the delivery side and with a lack of obsession about this delivery and what are the key solutions for your people. So I think on both sides, the key qualities and the main points of the different cultures are very useful on both sides because the world we are entering in, and especially due to all this change we discussed, will create a much more intricate environment between private sector and public sector. We spoke about climate, we spoke about social effects of innovation. All these issues are not issues reserved to the public sectors. If we want to succeed, and precisely if we want to have a better world, we have to create the common environment where people coming and working in the private sector will work much more closely with people involved in the public sector, creating common solutions, common dynamic, and common objectives. So you need precisely to bridge the gap between these different cultures and these different sectors.
Mike, was there a mantra that you took from the business world when you went into public office?
The difference between government and business is a lot less than people think. Everybody wants recognition and respect. Every organization really depends on its people. We still live in an analog world for all the digital platforms that we have. And the difference in how you compensate people, whether it's with money or with satisfaction, really doesn't matter. It's being able to put together a team and manage the team to deliver a product. That product could be picking up the garbage, educating the kids, keeping the public safe, or it could be producing steel or electronics or literature, whatever the case may be. And I think we make too big a difference, distinction between different. In government, most people think that businessmen are all crooks. Business people, sorry. In business, they think that most government people are stupid and lazy. And I can tell you, having worked in both sides, the proportions of brilliant, hardworking, innovative people is exactly the same. The proportion of lazy, dumb, venal people is exactly the same. There's no reason why government can't work well. There's no reason why businesses can't well. The fundamental difference is that businesses go out of business and governments never go out of business. And at the top, if you think about it, if the top of a company, the woman or the man that runs the company leaves, everybody moves up. In business, in government, if the top woman or man leaves, the top staff all move out. And so in business, the loyalty is to the company, and in government, the loyalty is to the head person. And it does give you some differences. But I think if you can get over the fact that in government, everything is exposed, business people have a tough time doing that, particularly if there are tapes of things that they said a long time ago to a TV camera they wish they hadn't said. The differences aren't all that great. It is hard for business people to understand that the public demands answers and the press is there to get them the answers. And in business, the answer is, I don't want to tell you, and if you don't like it, sell my stock. And you can't sell your government. You've got to stay. You're going to live there, so you demand answers.
How do you build a team? How do you build a team? This seems to be one of the most crucial things, right? When you're starting out and you're one of these entrepreneurs, you need to make sure that you're surrounded with the best.
Attracting and the care and feeding of your staff is the main job of an executive. When people say they're looking for a job, I always say, well, what do you want to do? Well, I want to go into biotech, or I want to go into into government or whatever. Take a yellow pad and write out, what do you want to do each day? I can tell you what I do each day. I get in, I've got to go through a bunch of newspapers, I've got to answer a bunch of emails, I've got to solve some political problems within the organization, I've got to greet customers coming in, I've got to go and give a speech. Mostly it's not policy. We all, particularly with our elected officials, we all think that we elect an official at the top to come up with great ideas and to execute. The problem is that the running the railroad, as I would call it, requires so much of the top executive's time that they can delegate downstream all of the creative stuff. What they can't delegate is showing up. And nobody wants the vice president to come and give a speech. They always want the president to give a speech. And so you find yourself doing that. If you can go out and delegate to some people to do things and have confidence in them and protect them when they get into trouble and fund them, then you'll find that you get the credit. I always say to kids, get rid of the words I and me and replace them with we and us. Because there's nothing that I can think of that you do on your own. Even you're out there on the television set yourself, but you still have that earpiece which somebody's telling you what to do. And then afterwards there was an editor or before that said these are the questions and this is what you should have done. And you know, you don't do it by yourself. An author doesn't write a book by themselves. They've got to have an editor. They've got to go out and sell it to a publisher. All of the things that we do in life is done cooperatively. And unfortunately, it's easy to teach facts. It's harder to teach how to think. It is very difficult to teach how to work cooperatively and collaboratively, and yet that those two things are the real reason people succeed.
The voice in my head always says, don't mess it up. How do you build a team?
Look, I think first you have to share values. You have to explain your values. I think that's critical because a team first share common values, common objectives, but what's the DNA of the team? You have to define that, and I think that's a critical role for leader. Because people join a team, they can join to follow you, and I share my view about the difference between politics and business, but defining common values, what's the objective? And answer the question, why first? Second, you have to accept to hire smarter people than you, more gifted people. The current reflex in an organization is always to avoid having smart people, especially in politics, I have to say, because you are always afraid of having people taking your job. But I think that's a big mistake. You need smart people. And that's true especially for, startups. You need to hire, it was true for young or older people and what Mike mentioned, but what you need is smart people. And I think that's a critical point to build a team, because it's how to push the team to grow up and to be successful. Because the day you start yourself to hire or associate somebody smarter than you are, he will do the same. And nobody will be insecure in the team. Because the most important thing is the dynamic of the team, with this value, with your objectives, and you are not the only one in charge of that, because you can delegate. That's a good reflex of a lazy man. You have to be slightly lazy to be successful in a team. And third, I think what you have to do is probably to motivate much more than just to convince. You have to convince people about key ideas. But it's impossible in a team to convince people about everything. You will have dissensus in the team, you have to accept that. But the key point is to motivate them. And because that's the best way to push innovation. That's true in politics, that's true in business, because if you motivate the team much more than you convince the team about everything they have to do, they will invent, they will create something you didn't have in your mind, which is the best possible result for a team.
One of the things that makes this so complex today to build a team is the millennials. I can't quite figure out what defines millennials, but millennials don't, in my experience, come in with the attitude of, I want to learn, I'm going to work here for a long time, I will feel an obligation to help the organization if the organization accepts me. Young kids today come in and sort of say, what's in it for me? And I'd like to come here to learn. Well, companies aren't there to teach you. Companies are there to get employees that produce. And when you look at the resume of a millennial that has 4 jobs in 6 years, why anybody would give them their 5th job, I have no idea. I would not want to hire somebody that goes there for a year and jumps to the next place. The advice I give young people when you're going to look for a job, the person on the other side of the desk has an obligation or an interest in finding good employees who will contribute to the organization, not in helping you. They want to know why you can help them. And when I talk to too many young people, they kind of tell me what they want to do for themselves rather than the reverse. If I hadn't gotten fired after 15 years, I would still be at the company that had hired me. In good times, there would never be reasons to leave, and in bad times, I would feel an obligation to stay with them to help them through the bad times. That, to me, is the social contract. Now, it may be an old-world view of things, but there's an awful lot to be said for stability and sticking around for a long enough period of time to get experience and to look for opportunities within the organization that gives you your first chance. And we've gotten to the point here, the culture is, and I think it's a fad, I think it will pass simply because an awful lot of millennials will not be able to succeed by doing this constant turning over and not really showing any, getting a real experience. I think you've just got to understand we work together long term, and if you're joining a team, somebody once said there's no I in the letter I in the word team. And that's hard today for millennials who are told the whole world is their oyster, they can do everything. It's not going to be their oyster. It's a very competitive world. And the more kids that get out of school, the more competitive it gets. And the more technology is there, the fewer people we're going to need working. And so trying to think, if I went, I had an opportunity to join two investment banking firms when I got out of graduate school. And one, I said, what would I do if I come to work here? And they told me explicitly where I would work and what I would be doing. And the other one, I asked the same question, and they said, how can we possibly answer that question? We have absolutely no idea what skills you have or what you're going to be able to do. What we want to do is put you in a pool and try to give you some experiences and opportunities and see whether you come to the top. And that made so much more sense to me that that's where I went to work rather than the first one, and for a lot less money.
Emmanuel, we're running out of time, so in quick 30 seconds, what's your best piece of advice for an entrepreneur that comes to see you today?
Accept to fail. Take the maximum of risk. And always try to find smart people accompanying you and brave people, i.e. in your team, to invest with you or as a client.
My piece of advice would be, you're never going to be smarter than everybody else in the room. And as we've said, you always want to hire people smarter than you in any case. But the one thing you can compete on is hard work. And I've always thought the person that comes in the earliest, stays the latest, takes the fewest lunch breaks, coffee breaks, whatever, is the person that is most likely to succeed, because you've got to be there when the opportunities present themselves. You've got to be there when you have a chance to network. You've got to be there when you have a chance to learn. And if you're not the hardest working one there, somebody else is going to work harder than you, and they're going to have all those advantages over you. So in the end, it is, it's not just, it's being there is 90%, showing up is 90% of life, but it's also showing up and paying attention that's 90% of life.
Gentlemen, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you
so much.